Hello and welcome to Custom Gamer. My name is Daz and this is the show where we talk about level design while playing cool maps. Today we're playing a Half-Life 2 Episode 2 release by MIGA called Perplexity. It's a map in the classic MIGA style, gorgeous to look at, some really interesting puzzles and kind of new game mechanics for us to learn, and some balls-hard combat to round it all out. I think the combat is perhaps the weakest part of this release, with the visuals and puzzles being way above it in terms of quality and enjoyment. We can talk about the specifics when we get to it, but right now just look at this gorgeous vista at the end here. MIGA has really outdone himself with this area here, just making it really stand out. It's a memorable area. You're not really going to mistake this for any other mod out there because it's fairly unique in the Half-Life 2 universe. As far as I'm aware anyway, it's a really interesting visual effect here, I really like it. Unfortunately it's never really explained in any kind of gameplay or story terms, it's just kind of there. I think that would work really, really well in an older game like say Quake, where stuff like this is to be expected. I think in Half-Life it needs a little bit of explanation. I'm not saying it's bad, I love it, it's just I would have liked some kind of lore surrounding this. But anyway, let's get into the map and have a look at it. Okay, so with this being a MIGA map, we have to sort of throw out our preconceptions of what a Half-Life 2 map is and build them from scratch again, which is always a really interesting thing to do with MIGA maps. Again, his maps are usually very, very abstract, and although visually very, very lovely to look at, some great lighting and effects, generally the maps don't make a lot of sense in a real-world kind of lens. The layouts are very, very functional to serve gameplay rather than actually feeling like a real place. And while everything is kind of clad in realistic textures and models and generally the map looks beautiful, it's definitely made with gameplay in mind first. This has always been the case with MIGA's maps. It's just his style, I guess. You can always tell a MIGA map because it's got these orange and blue highlights all over the place from the lighting. That's kind of his signature style that I can always tell a MIGA map just by looking at it. This mod features new music by Edward Rizza that you're hearing now. Hopefully I won't get a copyright strike from YouTube for including it. So this mod starts off fairly simple. The great thing from a level design perspective about this map is that it introduces a completely new mechanic to the player. With new visual language surrounding it, and it does so in a very, very effective way. We're going to talk about that a lot as we come across different instances of this new mechanic, but it's a fantastic example of how you should be implementing new mechanics. And it's just a fantastic piece of level design as well as we go through. There's a lot of interesting things to do, and lots of crazy contraptions to use and abuse. As you can see here, it's another classic MIGA trademark. This is kind of what I'm talking about when I'm saying the map is very, very abstract. It's very much gameplay first and puzzles first. Like, why would this exist here? Aside from adding some gameplay to for the player to solve. So here you're seeing these batteries in glass containers. This is another repeated visual motif. Now here is where we get our first glimpse at the new mechanics. We've got a shield wall here, but it's green, which indicates it should be different. And how these shield walls work is they will collide with physics objects in the world, but not the player. And that is the whole, that is basically as simple as it is, but you get some really interesting situations come from it. So here, the mechanic starts off very, very simple. You try to pull a physics prop through it and it won't work. Unfortunately, I didn't do that in this video. But basically, you can try to use a gravity gun to pull that ammo crate out and it doesn't work. It gets stuck behind the force field. So you have to turn the force field off, and it allows it to go through. So it's just kind of starting off very simple, just showing the player that these force fields will stop physics props. And then it slowly layers it up from there. It doesn't just throw the mechanic at you in a very complex state right at the beginning. So again here, the visual language is very, very clean in these maps. I really, really like it. So as soon as you come into this room, you see the battery receptacles here, and you know exactly what you have to do already, because you've already seen the mechanic earlier. It's very clearly explained. This is something Mig is really, really good at. This kind of stuff always shines in his maps. So the sparks there draw our attention to the hole in the wall. And now we can proceed here once we have the battery. That's a nice little trap. I don't know why I didn't just use the gravity gun to punt it away. I guess I just didn't think about that. But it's nice that you have time to think. It doesn't just drop a barrel on your head and explode. You actually, there's a bit of gameplay involved there, a little bit of thinking, even if I didn't really think that well. Now we can rearrange these batteries in order to progress to the next area. And this is that vista that I showed you in the intro. It does look really, really nice. I really wish this motif was tied into the gameplay, however. I mean, it's a gorgeous looking environment, but it's never really explained as to what it is or what's happening. It looks like kind of the fabric of reality is breaking down around this place, and that sounds like something that could work really, really well actually inside the map, for kind of rearranging rooms, you know, breaking parts of level. You could make some really, really decent puzzles with that, especially with the new force field mechanic in this map as well. So I feel like it's a really cool visual motif. It could have been so much more. It would have been really nice to get some more explanation as for what's happening here as well. Again, I think this ties back into the fact that Mega's maps never really make a lot of sense visually. They're just kind of, they look nice, but, you know, what is this place really? Apart from an abstract game environment. It never really tries to hide that fact very well. There's also a supreme lack of ambient sounds here, which I don't like either. Map's very, very quiet. So we can walk down the path here. I love the alternating orange and blue lights, that's kind of cool. I love the way you kind of walk into the darkness here, it's very, very cool. It looks great, when you turn around and look back you just see everything there with the black outline. I like it a lot. So here we see the green force field mechanic again, and now we realise that we can walk through these. So now the player knows that we can walk through them, but physics props are blocked by them. So now we know two different things about these force fields. Of course, the laser puzzle from Mega's other maps makes a brilliant return here. So we're looking for something to block the laser. Skip ahead here to where I find it, because it took me way longer than I'm ever going to admit to find that panel there. And again, we have to walk through another green force field here, so it's just re-emphasizing the mechanic. If the player didn't notice it the first time, hopefully they'll notice it this time as well. And again, you have to walk through them again on the way back as well. I think some more could have been done in this area here. It feels very, very strange to come over here, do all that just to pick up a weapon and then walk all the way back. It doesn't feel quite right. I think I would have liked to have something happen in that room, or the player does something, like perhaps even just something as simple as hitting a button that opens up something over here, just so the player realizes that this area has changed. And now we get to the combat. And unfortunately, this area would have been a great area to fight in, but you never get the chance to actually get into it unless you kind of rush in right at the very start. All the combine soldiers fill up this arena here very, very quickly, and you just don't get a chance to get anywhere. And this whole fight kind of devolves into sitting in this doorway, taking pot shots, and not really being able to do much else. It's really, really unfortunate. Now, if you could just shoot the panels out on the railings here and drop down, it would have been no problem, because you'd have an alternate route to explore. But you really are pigeonholed into this doorway here. And if you hesitate like I did at the start, you really are kind of screwed. The arena's really nice. There's lots of line of sight blockers, there's some walls, there's various crates and things that you can pick up. So it would have been a great fight if you could just get into the arena without being pigeonholed like this. Yeah, it's really unfortunate because this gets really, really annoying. So let's skip ahead a bit until I've killed most of them. I think I would have really, really liked it if no enemies had appeared until you'd actually gone onto the bottom floor here, and then you get a couple of combine repelling in from the ceiling, some coming from the sides, some hunters in through the front. It could have turned into a really interesting arena fight. You'd have a lot of options about where to go. There's various doors and windows all over the place in this room. You could retreat back up to the second level, but at least that would be a choice then. But as it stands, yeah, you really are just kind of stuck in that doorway. It's a real shame. Of course, you can just run forwards into it and I'm sure have a good fight, but it doesn't quite feel right just running headlong into so many enemies. I wonder how many people did kind of hesitate there and get stuck in the doorway like I did. Kind of interesting to hear. Mega always tends to have very cut and dry combat like this. I think combat in Harvard 2 is always best when it's kind of combined with something. Mega always tends to do combat very, very clinically, like there'll be an area designated for combat and that's all you do in it. Whereas I think Half-Life 2 is at its best when there's other things to do while in combat. So for instance, manipulating physics props to kill enemies, activating something in the environment which will help you, all kinds of things like this. But anyway, back to the puzzles. So this is where you first really get to interact with this new mechanic in a very kind of full-on way. So you can see here, we can turn on and off the green force field, which of course will support the physics prop, and then you have to use that in order to make a pretty tricky jump actually. You have to get the physics prop in just the right place so that you can do a long jump onto it and then a long jump onto the platform above. It's trickier than it looks actually. Yeah. It's a very simple puzzle, and the main purpose of it is just to make sure the player has learned everything that the author has been trying to tell them about these green force fields so far. Because you really can't complete the puzzle without understanding how it works. So now the player's completed a puzzle like that, as a map author you know that they understand the mechanic and you can start getting more complex with it, adding more moving parts, all these other things. I think the best thing about puzzle design is actually designing your puzzles so that the player actually understands how everything works, because there's nothing more frustrating in a game than staring at a puzzle and not understanding the mechanics behind each part of it. You really, really want to avoid that. Portal and games like Portal do a great job of things like this, because every single portal room in Portal is slightly more complex than the last one, or if it introduces a new mechanic, it goes back down to basics with that mechanic and then builds up again. Alright, so now we're back to the classic Mega Laser puzzle, and I like the fact that you have to use the block from the previous puzzle in order to solve this. That's kind of cool. Now, the mirror puzzle makes a return from Baryonic Predicament, Mega's last release map. Interestingly here, I think the mirrors are shown off better. So all the lasers we've seen so far in the map have used these mirrors, although they were non-interactive, they were just there bouncing the light. So the player has already seen the visual motif. If they're paying attention, they should know what to do here. I think in Baryonic Predicament, the mirrors were just kind of thrown on the player without any explanation. I think they've done much better here, as the player can actually see them refracting the laser beam before they actually have to interact with them. So that's another improvement. Just have to navigate through this, a vent full of water, because why not? Now this is where the player really has to show that they've learned the mechanics. So This kind of thing is not new to Half-Life. Again, there's been areas like this in the original Half-Life 2 where you have to make a platform across various things. Sand traps comes to mind, where you're kind of not trying to touch the ground by placing the various props. Exactly the same principle here, but of course done with the green laser bridge. So it's another interesting take on the mechanic. Now, unfortunately, in this video, I didn't take the crates with me. That's unfortunate, because if you do take them with you, at least one, but two is best, then you can get into the vent that's just been blown open by these manhacks, and there is some supplies in there for you. So that's really cool. It's an optional mechanic that makes the puzzle a little bit harder, but gives you a reward at the end. I really, really like this implementation, because if you're having trouble with puzzles like this, you can just ignore it, and the puzzle is slightly easier for it, but you don't get the reward at the end. I really, really like that. So it's kind of optional difficulty increases. It's a great way to do it. So yeah, if you'd taken the crates with you, you'd be able to stack them here and get into that vent and get some supplies, which is awesome. And now, in classic MIGA fashion, this is a combat room. Again, as an arena, it's fairly nicely laid out. The sight lines are incredibly long, though. I think this kind of hurts the gameplay a bit. There are some incredibly long sight lines in this kind of main corridor here, without a lot of cover. I would have really, really liked it if there had been some stuff blocking the hallways, like crates, or other things to hide behind, physics props to use. As it stands, it's a very, very kind of clinical, cut-and-dry MIGA-style arena, where you fight in it, but there's really nothing else to do. It's also really not clear where you need to go in order to progress this part of the map. I was walking around for quite a long time, just exploring everything. There's lots of kind of locked doors and places that look like you should go there, but they end up being absolutely nothing. And it turns out that there's a button inside one of the rooms that you have to press in order to start this ambush. But it's really, really not shown off very well, unfortunately. Now, as you're all probably well aware, I'm all for exploration in maps. I think exploration is an incredibly powerful and fun tool to use. Unfortunately, in this area here, because all the areas kind of look the same, it doesn't really feel like you're exploring, more just kind of randomly going from door to door and hoping that there's something in there to do. I think the visual language had to be stronger here. And now we fight! So there's various doors around this arena that open up to reveal squads of Combine soldiers. When these doors open, you can run into the doors, and there's usually supplies in there. Very, very similar to MIGA's Defendville map, actually. Where, once the doors open and the Combine come out, there's usually supplies behind those doors as well. Exactly the same principle here. This arena can actually be quite tricky. Because of the lack of cover and long sight lines, they can kind of pick you off from a distance. And there really are a lot of Combine behind each door, so trying to get in there quickly to grab supplies and whatnot can be difficult. Now we just have a couple of hunters to round it off at the end. I'm starting to feel like the hunter to finish off an ambush is getting a little bit kind of expected. It's not really a surprise anymore. I mean, they're fun to fight and everything, but I think it's getting to the point now where you just expect a hunter at the end. It's not really a big crescendo anymore. Maybe I've just played way too many Half-Life maps and I know the patterns. But yeah, this arena, again, it's very, very clinical. There's barely any physics props in it. There's no real kind of scripted events that happen or anything like that. So I think the combat is actually quite dull, unfortunately. Now we can go through this hole in the wall. Again, this isn't really explained to the player, so while you're fighting, I'm guessing a hunter breaks through that wall and comes at you, but the visual language is not very good. I didn't actually see it happen. So it's not the case of just wandering around aimlessly until you find it after the fight is over. Now, if you're paying attention, you're probably noticing that this corridor is getting thinner and thinner as you're walking through it. It's another interesting... I should start calling these things miggerisms. Just making up words now. Migga does as he pleases. So now we're back to the map strong point, which is definitely the puzzles. So, we're going from bad visual language to good visual language, where although a very, very abstract puzzle, it's very clear what you have to do. So we have to wait for the light beam and then hit the button. The first time I played this map, this puzzle actually really frustrated me because I guess I have very slow hands or something, because I found this very, very difficult to actually get the timing right. And if you miss one, they all reset. So it actually drove me a little bit crazy. And I'm actually quite amazed I did it so quickly this time around. Guess it's easier than I thought. So again here, we know the battery is important, so we take it with us. This I really dislike, what you're about to see here. So this platform just gets destroyed for absolutely no reason, and if you fall into that trap, 99% chance you're just gonna die outright. It really, really sticks out in a map that's been, you know, very well designed otherwise. Stuff like this really sticks out as bad design, because there's absolutely no visuals telling you that this platform is dangerous. There's been no precedent set so far in the map that platforms like this are going to fall. I mean, if the map had been falling apart around our ears, then it would probably feel better, though I still wouldn't like it. This just feels completely out of the blue random. And the player cannot anticipate it, which is the main issue here. They have absolutely no idea that that's going to happen. Though I really dislike that. After we've done that, we find ourselves in the final combat arena of the mod. Now again, this arena recycles some mechanics from Baryonic Predicament, so we've got the crate dispensers, where you hit a button and two supply crates will pop out of the ground, and then the supply crate dispenser will go on a short cooldown period before you can use it again. I really like the mechanic. Keeps the player moving around the arena to use different supply dispensers. It's very, very cool. Before we get to that, we've got a short puzzle here. This is really fun. I like this a lot. Again, it's a simple mechanic, simple puzzle, but just really fun to do. Now, this final combat can be very, very punishing. I've died here quite a lot. You have sizable waves of combine. And you really do have to move around the map to survive here, thanks to these supply dispensers. Such a great mechanic, I love it. Anything that promotes movement around the map is great in my opinion. I really dislike it when Half-Life 2 maps kind of devolve into stand in a doorway and shoot stuff. It starts feeling more like Call of Duty than Half-Life when that happens. So anything that can get the player to move around is great. Now, I wasn't too sure about the music at the start, but it's actually warmed up on me. I quite like it now. It's always a good idea to explore this arena before you start the combat, just to learn where all the dispensers are, because you really are going to need them. The shotgunners are the ones you really want to look out for here. I will absolutely wreck you in this arena. I'd say that some areas in this arena are perhaps a little dark. Aside from that, it looks beautiful. And there's lots of cover in it, which I like. This is kind of what I was hoping. The first bit of combat in the mod, by the reality distortion arena, as I'll call it, I wish was more like this, where you actually had time to look around the arena, get some supplies before you got assaulted by Combine. This is how that first fight should have been. It's really unfortunate that you're kind of stuck in a doorway. There's some nice enemy variety here as well, so you get Combine soldiers at first, now we start getting manhacks, and then a nice little surprise at the end as well that I wasn't expecting, which is very cool. Yeah, all these cover objects in the centre of this arena are absolutely essential. This arena would be really annoying if it was just a big open room with no cover. It's really important that they're there. Gotta find some more dispensers pretty quickly. Getting a little bit low on health. And suddenly antlions. I really like this change-up. Again, it's completely Megastar. It's very, very gamey. Like, suddenly antlions. Why? It doesn't matter. It's just fun. Trying to get some supplies without getting acided in the face. And then, of course, hunters to finish it off. All in all, this is a great arena. It's paced out nicely. It's very, very difficult, but certainly survivable if you play well, utilize the environment to your advantage, and use all the ammo dispensers. It's a really nice challenge. Right, it's very easy to design an arena where you could put in all these mechanics and they're just not needed because it's too easy. Whereas I think Mega's got a really nice balance here where you need the dispensers to survive, and the enemies do kind of push you around the arena and present a very serious threat. So yeah, fantastic. Love the final combat. So there you go, that was Perplexity by Mega. Grab it on Planet Philip. The link is in the description below the video, as always. Mega's getting really, really good at maps. If I was going to say anything, I'd say the combat is definitely the weakest part of that release. And I think it's never really been bad in Mega's maps, but it's certainly the weakest part. He's definitely got puzzles and visuals down to a T. Just needs to work on bringing that combat up to scratch, I think. Alright, more videos coming soon. See you next time.